My music is a combination of all my own influences, and I guess for me, every album or every phase of my life, like anybody, goes through different ch changes.
Experiences.
Exactly. So, whereas my first album was kind of influenced, I would say, by a lot of French, singers mixed with a lot of, very traditional rock and soul
Gainsbourg
music.
and these people,
Yeah, exactly. So that was coming from that. Then, I moved on to like different influence of a lot more jazz coming into it. Then, as I move along, more electronica, kind of heavier in the electronica, and then that tapers off, and then to now where I would say my sort of sonic place is really quite minimal, actually. Minimal instrumentally, but rich musically. So I wanted a pretty much a very stripped down sound for this album. I'm not going to say there are certain artists who purposely go out of their way to make obscure music, but I think in doing that, it leaves out a good chunk of people who wouldn't understand it anyway. So it's interesting because I've never I've you know I don't gravitate naturally towards artists who I'm going to say make popular music. I've always liked artists who have some twist or something unusual or extremely original, which isn't going to be easily digested by most people. I mean, those are the artists who I tend to sort of gravitate towards.
And what was the first album that you made, actually? How was it to make that?
How was it to make it?
How was it? How do you feel about going to the studio and to actually put something in the public view?
Interesting. My first album was Head Music on Columbia, which was, like I was saying, very. The idea behind the album was to combine jazz and rock. So and soul with a soul kind of feeling to it. So the actual musicians were exactly that. It was Anthony Johnson on drums, who was the original member of 24/7 Spice. I don't know if you know
Don't
that.
remember, no.
They were like before Fishbone. They were like the. And unfortunately, they split up after I think their second album because they were really very like very dynamic group. So he was the original drummer for 24/7 Spice. Then there was Leon Dorsey on bass, who studied with Ron Carter and was on the road with Lionel Hampton for a long time. Then there was a very like traditional rock guitar player. And then Peter on keys, who's Peter, who was then my husband. So we worked together for many years. This album I've produced all on my own, because Peter's not making music anymore. But so is this a blend of all this, plus a lot of electronic elements. So it was pretty much, I would say, it set the, like, it was the thesis statement, I would say, of like everything I would do, like after that. It pretty much set the stage for my sound, I suppose. And I mean, it did very well on the press level, but up at Columbia, I mean, they were kind of not that. They were a little confused by the record, I would say, because it also spawned a single, which was a number one dance hit, which went on to be sort of considered a club classic. So
yeah.
The label, they understood that because, okay, they understood the dance music, you know. But yeah, there was this album, 1992, which was this blend of all this stuff.
Yeah.
They didn't get it. It was like, they wanted something that could work at radio and
yeah, sure.
So, but it did well for me in the sense that it really it kind of it put me out there as a person who kind of makes their own, has their own thing, has their own sound.
Mm-hmm.
And my albums have been, each album I do has a little bit of head strains of head music in it, and this album kind of does harken back to it. Because there's a lot of live playing on this album.
So, I mean,
it was a great experience making that album.
Mm. An unforgettable moment in time.
Yeah, it was. And I had total creative control, which I've had on all my albums. So, it was really pure fun and pure experimental, just adventurous kind of exploration of my, of my own sound.
Mm.
And that's what came out.
Hitting from the left and the right.
Exactly.
What are your thoughts about jazz? Are there any jazz musicians do you really admire, or when you were growing up?
Oh, geez. I would say, there are so many. I would say, of course, Lester Young.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Coltrane. Oh, gosh. Billie Holiday being my favorite singer.
Yeah.
I would say, it's like, it's Ron Carter, who I mentioned.
Mm.
McCoy Tyner, who I love. Wynton Kelly. Sarah Vaughan, who I also love.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the list is is a long one. Miles, of course.
Yeah.
I love the minimalism that he can achieve. I just think it's...
Yeah, they took it to the disco a bit, didn't they? I mean, if you look at a lot of that, all the trip-hop things and all that, it's got that, it's Miles Davis all over it, isn't it? So they took it to the disco.
Oh, God, yeah.
I don't know if it was screaming while it was being dragged there, but... Yeah, I think it's good for the next generation to hear that kind of thing.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
But I love old jazz. I love classic jazz.
Mm.
And just a lot of the stuff that was coming up, that's why this album was such an adventure for me, because and that's why YouTube is so fabulous, because you can go back in time and see, jazz dance, which was very exciting because, here are these women dancing to this music. So it was like this double kind of very, I guess what some people would have described as illicit, activity going on. So these women dancing. And, to me, it's very interesting because I also come from a dance background. So I think that time was so unique.
Yeah.
Because you had all this going on. You had a mix of people
mm-hmm.
doing all, engaging in this activity, which was illegal. So, but they're all in it together,
mm-hmm.
So it's, I just think as like a time capsule, it's an interesting time to look at that
mm-hmm.
because, the whole idea of prohibition.
Yeah.
It's like so much came out of that.